Hello everyone, our today's topic is program interrupt. So we are going to talk about what are the types of interrupt and why they are caused. So we will firstly talk about the external interrupts. So external interrupts are those interrupts which are not caused from inside the CPU. They are the factors which due to which the interrupt happens are from outside, like any input output device causes an interrupt, or there is any timeout from like a device which is connected, like printer is there which is connected with your device, with your computer, and it is not responding. So there is a timeout error. There might be a power failure. There might be an operator who is giving any kind of a interrupt, like we click Control Shift Delete. So that is a interrupt. And this type of interrupt is a external interrupt. Now the next type is internal interrupt. The internal interrupts are those interrupts which are caused by running a program. So when your system is running a program, it in between, if its register is getting full or there is any problem of stack, like stack memory is full, so then there will be an internal error. And divide by zero is one of them. If you divide a certain value by zero, so the interrupt which is generated, that is a internal interrupt. So opcode and protection violation is that sometimes we don't want to allow certain codes to execute. So that will be a opcode violation. Next is protection violation. Now what is protection violation? Just imagine that in your computer, there are two users. In one user, you don't allow someone to use a certain portion of your hard drive, or you don't allow someone to access a certain software from your username. So if he tries to use that partition of the hard drive or that software, your system is going to restrict it. So that is a kind of protection violation. Means if a user has restricted or admin has restricted someone to access certain services, but still he tries to do that, so then it is a kind of protection violation. You might have seen such kind of things implemented in your labs. If you try to use a pen drive in your lab computers, so you will not be able to do that. That is a kind of protection violation interrupts which are generated, which gives you an error that you can't change. There is another type of interrupt which is generated. If you want to change the timing of your computer in your lab, so you will not be able to do that because you are not allowed to perform that task. So that is when you see that screen of the error, that is your internal interrupt. After this, we have software interrupts. So in software interrupts, we have these are the interrupts which are generated by your computer hardware as well. And there can be a software interrupts as well. When we talk about the hardware interrupt, they can be external or internal, but software interrupts are those which happen due to the execution of an instruction. So what is it? Your system jumps from supervisor mode to user mode, or from user mode to supervisor mode. Now what is this user mode and supervisor mode? When your system is dependent on the input from a user, then it is in a user mode. Like if when your system is asking you for a username and password, so that is a user mode. But when your system is executing on its own, like when it is booting up, so while it is booting up, it doesn't need you to feed any kind of information, so it works on its own. So that is its supervisor mode. So your system keeps on switching between supervisor mode and user mode. So when your system doesn't expect any input from you, then it is on a supervisor mode. When it is expecting an input from the user, then it is a user mode. So there are certain set of operations which are not allowed to run in a user mode. So to run those type of instructions, your system needs to be in a supervisor mode, and it automatically switches to that. Then next thing is interrupt procedure. So we have studied about something known as interrupt cycle. We studied about interrupt cycle, that your system, if it is executing certain instruction, and in between if we have certain statements, it jumps from that instruction to some other instruction and start executing that instruction. So that was the interrupt cycle. So, and one other thing which we have studied about interrupt cycle was we were having a two type of cycles. First one was the instruction cycle, second was interrupt cycle, and it was based on the value of R. If the value of R is 0, then it is on instruction cycle. If its value is 1, then it is on interrupt cycle. Now let us talk about what your system has to do when it is in a interrupt cycle. So when we talk about branch conditions, so in branch conditions we only say that the value of program counter is stored at address register. Like if it is a branch save address, the value of program counter is shifted to a location which is AR. So we say that once we have stored that value, then we can execute anything. But when we are actually on an interrupt cycle, by only saving the value of program counter, we can't execute any instruction. Now, if you want to actually go on an interrupt cycle, there are number of other things which you need to store. So there are such values like what is the content of PC that is required, what are the different contents of all the processor registers, whatsoever is stored in IR, DR, TR, you have to store that. You have to also get the status of all the status bits. What are the status bits? We will discuss about them. You have to store that value. So how we are actually going to store those all values is dependent upon the architecture of your computer. Okay. So whenever an interrupt is generated and your system shifts to some other subroutine to execute, it needs to save all these values, which includes your PC value, processor register, and all the status bits. So it needs to store that. Now, where it has to store that, that is a matter of discussion. Where we are going to store that value. So it might be provided by your, you can say, architecture of your computer, that this is a particular location where every time whenever your system is going to go on an interrupt procedure, it will be storing that data at a single particular place, or it might be provided inside a program that if there is any interrupt, so you have to store your data at this particular location. So it depends upon that. Now, let us move to the next part. What is a program control instruction? Now, as you all use different high-level languages, which we have in that, like go-to statements, go-to statements, jump statements. So we have all that kind of instructions. Now, how those all instructions get executed on your computer? They are with the help of these program control instructions. So program control instructions, we have branch instruction, which is having a mnemonic code of BR, jump, JMP, skip, SKP, call, return, compare, and test. So we are having different program control instructions. Now program control means it controls the flow of your program. Like normally if I execute a particular program, so what is our process? It is a sequential type of execution. Firstly, first instruction will be executed, then second, then third, then fourth, then fifth. But if we use any one of these instructions, like program control instruction, we can shift from one normal flow to, we can skip a certain part of it and we can move to the next instruction. So that is what we call for program control instructions. So these are those instructions which control the flow of your program, that how you are going to execute a program. Those instructions which will control the flow of your program are known as program control instructions. So which are namely branch, jump, skip, call, return, compare, and test. So these are some of the program control instructions. Now let us move to the next topic. The next topic is related to flag and processor status word. So this is very important. So we just discussed that when we are going to move on an interrupt procedure, we have certain values which we need to store. And what are those? Processor register values and status bits. So what are status bits? That is this status word which we have. All the values which we have in these are your status bits. And when we combine them, it becomes a status word. Now, what is it? It actually stores several values. So the first value which we have, that is V. It is for overflow. V is for overflow. If you remember, we studied a case like in which we were going to shift the data by using arithmetic shift left. So if we do a arithmetic shift left for this, we said that we will be having an XOR gate at this place, and this XOR gate will tell us whether there is an overflow or not. If there is an overflow, then that will not be executed. So we have talked about this thing. If both the bits are same, then it is fine. If both the bits are different, then it is not possible to perform a arithmetic shift left. So we discussed about that. Now, where that value of XOR is stored, it is stored in V. So V is just there to check the overflow condition once you have processed your data inside the ALU. So this, in this diagram, you can see we have a 8-bit ALU, which is starting from 0 and ending at 7. So F0 to 7 means there are 7 values in it, 8 values in it. So there will be 8 bits of data in it. Now, if we talk about 8 bits, I will just write 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, then 256. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. If there are unsigned values which we have, the maximum number of bits, the maximum size of, or the maximum value which we can store, if it is a signed data, then the maximum values which we can store will be based on this. So either we can have positive 127, or we can have a value which is minus 128. So why it is like this? Because if it is a 7-bit and signed values, then the maximum sum which we can have from this is positive 127 or negative 128. So this is how we are going to have the maximum value in it. If it is an unsigned number, then the maximum value which we can have is 256. Because if we sum all the values like 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, and 128, just sum up all these values, it will become 255. Okay, so it will be simply 128 plus 127. So this will be the value, not 256. Okay. So if there are signed numbers, then the value which maximum it can store is minus 120, plus 127 to minus 128. So this V which we are having, it only stores the overflow condition. Now it will simply test that if we perform any kind of left or right operation, is there any difference between the last two significant bits or not? If it is there, then this V value will get a value 1. So it means there is a overflow. Next is the Z bit. Z bit, if you check, Z bit is connected with the output. So Z bit simply identifies whether the output from the ALU is 0 or not. If the output from the ALU is 0, this Z value will become 1. If the output of the ALU, this is a ALU, if the output of ALU is all zeros, the value of Z will become 1. So this is the other bit which we have. Then after this, there is another bit which is known as S bit. which is a sign bit. So I sign bit is simply to calculate or to find out what is the sign of the most significant bit of the ALU's result. Like if we are getting a result from ALU, such as we get a value 1 0 1 0 1 1 0 0, it will only work on this. What is the sign of this? Whether it is 1, if it is 1, it will be a negative value. If it is 0, it means it is a positive value. So if it is a signed number, so then it will work. So S is used to store the sign, whether it is a positive number or is it a negative number. So that will be done by S, that is sign. After it, we have the last value, which is carry, which is a carry value. So just if we are having 8 values at this place, 8 here, 8 here, and I sum up 2 8-bit values, one zero one zero one zero one, so we get a value of carry. This carry which we have will be sent to the status, or you can say the carry bit which we have. So that will be stored in this C value which we have at this place. And once we combine all these 4 values, this becomes our processor status word. So this, when we combine V, Z, S and C, so this becomes a processor word, or you can say status word for a processor. It will be a processor status word. Is a processor status word. Now, according to this processor status word, we have certain conditional branch instructions. Now, what are these conditional branch instructions? When we talk about the different status which we receive on our processor status word, which we have, so your S, V, Z, and C, when we have different values on this. So according to that, there are certain branch conditions which execute. If you have certain, you can say branches, so it executes like that. So in the first one, we have branch if 0. So what does it mean? If the value of Z is 0, so what is going to happen? So we on the basis of this processor status word, there will be certain branch conditions which are related to it. So Z is only to calculate the value of 0, that whether the all the outputs of our ALU are 0 or not. So if it is 1, it means all the values are 0. So it will branch. If we are talking about the branch condition, it is written as BZ. BZ is branch if 0. Then if we talk about N, N value is for not. So branch if not 0. Same, we have BC based on this C value. Branch if there is a carry value. Branch if there is no carry value, BNC. Then branch if plus. This is another. Branch if plus. Branch if minus. So now these two values are based on this sum value which we have. So it is based on this S value which we have. So S is for our sign bit. So if there is a sign, so according to that we are going to perform this B, M and BP. Then we have the value of V. So branch if there is an overflow, branch if there is no overflow, BNV. Branch if there is no overflow. So these two are based on V. V is equal to 1, V is equal to 0, these two are based on the basis of your S value. If S is 0, then we are going to perform the plus branch if plus, and this if S is equal to 1, branch if minus. Then C value, C is 0 or 1. According to that, we are going to perform the branches. These are some of the branch conditions which we have. So we have seen this thing here. This is all for this single command, branch. For branch, we are having these possible conditions in which this branch instruction can be executed. So we can base our branch process on all these instructions. So after this, after branch, we have something different, which is comparison between unsigned and signed numbers. So if the numbers are unsigned or signed, so according to that, we have branch if higher. This is just a comparison between the magnitude of two numbers. We are not talking about the sign. We are only talking about the magnitude. So if A is higher in magnitude or A is higher and equal, then this will happen, BHE or BHI. If it is lower, then this instruction. Then if it is equal, then BE or BNE will be executed. So same thing is here in signed numbers as well. So this is just a comparison between the two values of A and B, which we have at this place, A and B. So it will simply compare those values and get those results here. And according to that, our data is going to execute. So branch if lower, branch if higher. So these are other condition, you can say branch instructions, which we can execute. This is on the basis of these status words. And these are based on the magnitude of these two numbers. So there are number of ways with which you can branch your processor from one execution to another. After this, we have the next topic, which is subroutine call and return. So these are how we are going to call the values, subroutine call and return. So we have call subroutine, we have jump subroutine, we can have branch subroutine, we can have branch and save return address. So this branch to subroutine is BUN instruction. This branch and save return address is BSA instruction. Call and jump are different. So most important are the two most important operations are implied, which we are using. Branch to the beginning of the subroutine. Now, what is happening in this? Whenever we are executing a particular program and we have certain other part of the code which is written, this is a subroutine when we are going to execute it. This is the normal sequence which we were following. Instead of executing this fourth instruction, if my system jumps to this place, so this will be branched to the beginning of the subroutine. This is subroutine one. Means this is not in the regular schedule of your CPU's execution. This is something which is separate. Then save return address. This was simply just jumping to this place, not saving any kind of address. But once you are using the branch and save return address, at this place in the starting, you are going to store your returning address. Save the return address to go to the address of the location, calling program on exit from the subroutine. Means when you are going to finish the execution of this program, you will be returning to this place and then later on to the actual place. This is same as that of your BS instruction. So locations for storing the return address, where you can store the returning address, like in this case the returning address will be 4. Now where you can store it, so there are different locations on which you can store it. It can be a fixed location in the subroutine, like it might be 0th location, or it might be some location or any location in memory. It might be some processor register, or it might be a memory stack. It can be a stack where you are going to store the return address. So to store that return address, this is your operation, call and return. It is just simply the push operation for memory stack. This is the pop operation for your memory stack. We did this in the LastPass as well at this stage. Push it is decrement by one, and for pop it is increment by one. You can check this is the same thing here. For call it is increment, so it is sequence your stack pointer is decremented by one. Here it is return, which is pop operation, so it is a increment by one. Because we are referring to the memory stack, we are not referring to the register stack. Now after this, we have comparison of two different architectures of our processors. So first one is CISC, second is RISC. So CISC is complex instruction set computer. RISC is reduced instruction set computer. Now RISC and CISC, the generally which we the processors which we use in your laptops are CISC processors, and the processors which we use in your mobile phones, they are RISC. They are portable, they are less small, and you can say they are quite efficient, but they are not as fast as your desktop processors are. The problem of CISC is it is very complex, it generates a lot of heat. So there are certain problems with CISC. So we will discuss about that. Then after that, we have RISC, reduced instruction set computer. Now, what does it mean? So we will discuss that thing in RISC and CISC in ahead of your chat in the next slide. Now, if we are having more number of instructions, now simply if we talk about CISC, it is a complex instruction set computer. Now, what does it mean? In this, we are having more number of instructions to execute. So we can choose from different instructions to execute some work. So it is having many number of instructions available. So you can choose which instruction I want to execute. But what does it do? It helps the compilers to compile the data at a faster speed. Okay. So, and it is also helping us to have more you could say flexibility to execute the data. The architecture is better. This is the benefit of CISC. So we call it as when we are trying to you can say program it, like if we are using a high level language, then it is easy for us to map that high level language with the instruction which is available on your CISC architecture, because CISC is having more number of instructions and it is easy to map that for a particular high level language command, which command we can use from CISC architecture. Because we are having more number of commands, so it is easy to do that. So that is CISC. Now, what is the other thing in this? In CISC, any command, whichever command we have, can access memory. Now, as we have discussed earlier, so we have a command like add R1, R2, R3. There are three registers. What is it? Add the content of R2 and R1 and store the content in R1. R2 and R3 and store it in R1. So we have number of accesses to memory. So any instruction, like this is an add instruction, even add instruction can access memory. So due to this reason, there are more number of memory accesses in the case of CISC. In when we talk about RISC, we will discuss what are the different commands which can access memory in CISC. So the instruction that takes three memory cycles to execute. Now this is going to take three memory cycles to execute, means that what we have studied about that T0, T1, T0, that timing cycles. So if this is T0, T1, T2, T3, T4, T5, so and so on. If this is fetch phase, this is decode phase, Then in execution, we will require three timing cycles. So this will be used for execution, this will be used for execution, this will be used for execution. So it will require three different three different clock cycles to execute a single instruction. So instructions, the program can be small, but the time which is taken by a single instruction to execute is high. So that is the problem with complex instruction set architecture. So it simply makes the execution cycle long. That is the problem. Another problem is the complexity of the design. Like, there is a huge design complexity in this, so which will slow down your processor. If there is any problem in the implementation, you are going to suffer. And there are certain instructions sets or instructions, or you can say addressing modes, which we never use. So whatsoever we have studied about the SIS, that are your more number of addressing modes, like we have studied register, you can say your register indirect, implied mode, we have studied immediate mode, we have studied about auto increment, auto decrement. So there are number of such you can say things available, but they are very rarely used. So that is the problem with complex instruction set computer. Now the last type which we have, these are the some of the criticism of CISC, that is, it is having complex and lengthy instructions. There are multiple memory cycles required. Okay, so just give a glance on it. So what are the different problems which we have? So we need to multi-program the systems. So that is something which we have. Then after this, we have RISC. Now RISC is reduced instruction set computer. Reduced instruction set computer has simplified the task of different addressing modes. Instead of having 8 or 10 addressing modes, it is having only 2, direct and indirect. Okay, the number of instructions which we are having, like in CISC, it was having a complex architecture for the instructions. So now in this case, we are having less number of instructions. So if there are few instructions, there are few addressing modes, the only instructions which can access the memory are load and store. So only load and store can access memory, no other instruction. Like in CISC was add was also able to use the memory cycles, but in RISC architecture only load and store will use that access to the memory, others will not. And all the instructions which we are going to have, they are going to have a fixed defined length. No instruction can exceed that length. And to execute one instruction, only one memory cycle is required. Like as we talked earlier, if we are having one instruction like load or store or any add or anything, so the only amount of cycles which we need is one. So only in single clock cycle, one instruction will be executed. So that is what fetch and decode is going to take same amount of time. Fetch, decode will be there. But for execution of that instruction, only one cycle is required. Fetch and decode will be same. Now, this is something which is important. Please remember, in the case of RISC architecture, we use a hardwired control unit. We don't use a micro-programmed one. Please remember this. It uses a hardwired controlling unit. It doesn't use a micro-programmed controlling unit. Now, what is a hardwired programming, hardwired control unit? It is the same unit which we did earlier, which was with IR. This was the instruction. We have an opcode which was then feeding up into the decoder. So we were having a decoder at this place. We were having a decoder here. 3:8 decoder was there. Then we were having D0 to D7. So then there was a controlling unit which we have. This is known as a hardwired controlling unit. Whereas micro-programmed controlling unit, we have certain set of memories in it. So inside that memory, our data is stored that what type of instruction is it, how to execute that instruction. So that is stored inside a memory. So that is known as a micro-programmed control unit. Your laptops, simply just remember it in this way. Your laptops are CISC architecture. They use micro-programmed controlling unit. Your mobile phones are RISC architecture, or they are based on RISC architecture. So they use a hardwired controlling unit, which you have studied. So this is, after this, we have the last unit, which is just simply telling you about what are the different benefits of it, how RISC was evolved, so how we are going to work on it. So it is just related to that. So hardwired control unit, which we are using in your mobile phones, is fast as compared to the CISC. CISC are more capable, but they are a little bit slow. So this was all for your unit, and your syllabus is complete. Thank you so much, everyone, for your time. Thank you.